All right, once again, good evening. As we continue our big celebration of Terry Gibbs, and tonight, you know, last night I got a chance to hear some of the big band material from the Woody Herman Second Herd, or the Four Brothers Band, that the band that Terry Gibbs was in. But, you know, Woody also had a tradition going back to the 1930s of a small group out of the band, as many of the big bands of the swing era had a small group within the big band. Woody had the Woodchoppers. And going back to the late 1930s, the Woodchoppers would do some recordings and do appearances on various programs. In the first Herd era, the Woodchoppers appeared quite often on those Wild Root shows, appeared in the Carnegie Hall concert, and then again there were the classic series of Woodchoppers pieces written by Ralph Burns and Shorty Rogers that included things like Igor and you know, the Chubby Jackson things and all those. And anyway, on into the band that that Terry was in, there were some Woodchoppers things that would appear from time to time at places like the Royal Roost, the Shrine Auditorium in Los Angeles, and various places. We the People Bop, and a number of things that kind of fit the second band, or the second Herd, as well as they would often resurrect some of the Woodchoppers things from the earlier things. You know, Fanet goes all the way back to the late 30s band, but then was modernized over the years to a point where, you know, it kind of fit. Woody continued this Woodchoppers into the third Herd, certainly, and there were small group things out of the big band through the years as well. So we thought it might be appropriate tonight, because of our celebration of Terry Gibbs, to include music from that small group, from the Woodchoppers out of the big band of which Terry was a part of there in 1948, 1949. So here are our Woodchoppers. Please welcome them. And Ken Peplowski, once again on clarinet, Chuck Red on vibes, and we'll introduce the rest, but we've got some Woody Herman alumni Woodchoppers, and we'll get to it. Here is Ken Peplowski, Chuck Red, and the Woodchoppers.
That's enough. Hold your applause. Okay. What? That's fine. Sorry. So as Ken pointed out, these are all most of these are pre-Terry Gibbs charts. But as you'll hear, even then, Woody cottoned onto the bebop thing right away. He was so aware of all the changes in music throughout his career. So these small group things were way ahead of their time, many of them. And the first one we're going to do is, in a way, kind of a follow-up to Caledonia. And you'll hear this when the bad vocalist comes in. You'll hear what I'm talking about. But this is a song called Fan It. Go out and get yourself five sets and fan it. Gotta fan it. Fan it. Gotta fan it and cool it. Fan it until the cows come home. Met myself a good girl named Sue. Taught me how to love it. Just what to do. You gotta fan it. You gotta fan it. Gotta fan it. Cool it. Fan it until the cows come home. You gotta fan it in the morning. Fan it at night. Fan it, baby. Fan it right. You gotta fan it. You gotta fan it. You gotta fan it. Cool it. Fan it until the cows come home. Take it, Ron. Or take it, Chuck. Somebody, take it. Thank you. so much. Thank you. Let me take a moment and introduce the ladies and gentlemen of the orchestra. We have a great trumpet player, Mr. Ron Stout. Mr. Gerry Pinter on the tenor saxophone. A nice aged horn there. Mr. Chuck Redd on the vibraphone. Mr. Tom Griep at the piano. Miss Katie Thiroux at the bass. And what's the drummer's name again? Of course, you know this gentleman here. It's because he's related. He's Terry's grandfather, Gerry Gibbs. Here's a tune written by Red Norvo, who played on a lot of these early Woodchoppers records, and Shorty Rogers collaborated on this one, and it's called Heads Up. Right now, we're going to feature one of my favorite trumpet players. Is he here? Yes, he is. He, right there, Mr. Ron Stout. Ron, you want to? Yeah.
My best. I got on Woody Herman's band rather late in Woody's life in 1984 and spent about 3 years with the old man. And almost every night, regardless whether it was a concert or a dance or a festival, he would feature me on Come Rain or Come Shine. So I'd like to play that. Not exactly like we used to play it. We used to play the beautiful arrangement by, help me out, trumpet player,
Stapleton.
Yeah, Bill Stapleton, right, who was very good to me and actually recommended me for Bill Holman's band, which led to my getting on Woody Herman's band. But I want to mention something about this because playing it every night can be a special kind of a challenge. And, you know, there was a style of approaching a solo that was kind of old school, and I liked to do it because I had a chance to do it every night with that song, which was kind of fashion a solo that was a really concrete, good solo. And then about once a month or so, I would just throw it out and try a completely new solo. And I might find one or two things that I could add to the master solo. This is an old school way of doing things, like, you know, the old big bands would take it on the road for 3 months or 6 months and then go and record it. So these guys had solos worked out, you know. And, you know, I never got any kind of response from anybody. Did this for years on the band. And no response from anybody in the band ever. The guys would never say anything about it, which is fine. I just was communicating with the rhythm section on that particular tune. And I didn't have any problem with that. Nobody ever complained about it or said they liked it or hated it or anything. So I just went about my business with it. And we were down in Orlando, Florida, and we played a night at a little concert hall there, and it happened to be the night when I just threw out the master solo, and I went for something new. And after the gig, I was helping tear down the band with the bass trombonist, Joe Verratti. And he says to me, "Hey man, you didn't play your solo on Come Rain tonight." So I kind of bugged him. He said, "So? What do you care?" And he said, "Man, my folks were here." I felt terrible. I never knew anybody was paying attention. Here's Harold Arlen's Come Rain or Come Shine.
is for Ron Stout. Beautiful. Beautiful, Ron.
We the people.
I'd like to make a declaration before we do this next song. If you all raise your right hand and repeat after me, please. We the people bop. Thank you.
That's the name of the next song.
Thank you. I don't know about you, but I just love those Richard Rodgers and Lawrence Hart lyrics. Ilya ah, Ilya ah, Ilya ah, ah ah. Beautiful poetry. Now, usually, you know, we are so grateful that you're here with everything that's happened in the last couple of years, and we don't like to complain about the audience members, right, guys? However, Ron Stout came to me backstage. He was really bugged, and I said, what's the problem, Ron? Because usually he's so great to work with, right? Am I right? Yeah. Am I right? Yes. But this time he was clearly steaming, and I said, what's the problem? He said, these people, he said, they won't leave me alone with requests. And I said, well, what are they asking for? And apparently about 15 different people came up to him and said, why aren't you playing anything from the Abbott and Costello movie, Ride 'Em Cowboy? Well, we're gonna do that for you right now to those people that have asked. So Ron, you won't be tortured anymore. This was a song written for the Abbott and Costello movie, Ride 'Em Cowboy, in 1942. There were so many great songs. Actually, we could do a show around songs written for Abbott and Costello movies. There's a lot of great ones. No kidding. Because those guys were, you know, they filled up those movies with just classic songs. And this one was one of Woody Herman's few records that made the charts. Not very high. It was in the 60s on the charts, not the 1960s. It was like number 64 on the Billboard charts. Still, that was impressive, and it was his recording of I'll Remember April. Thank you. Still a great song. Actually, it just occurred to me, another great song from an Abbott Costello movie. Does anybody remember the song Remind Me? It's beautiful, too. Dean Martin had a great record of that. Yeah, that was... But that premiered in an Abbott and Costello movie, actually. Fascinating. Okay. I'm going to let that one die on its own, Chuck. Okay. Right now we're going to do a tune that Woody played, I think, throughout his whole career, actually. This is a great song by, I think Al Cohn wrote this, is it correct? This is called The Goof and I. Thank you. Yeah, Katie Thoreau. Gerry Gibbs, beautiful. Yeah. And right now we're going to feature just an amazing saxophonist, Mr. Gerry Pinter, and he's going to tell you all about this next tune. Here we go. Oh, yeah, Ron. Go ahead. Both of you can talk. Everybody can talk. We can take questions from the audience.
Let me tell you about Amway. No, I want you to know that Gerry and I got on Woody's band in 1984, about 10 days apart from each other. So we had the new guys on the band. And the pertinence of this thing we're about to play, it's especially pertinent because the very last album that we made with Woody, we still made one or two Woody Herman albums after he was gone. But the last one that he actually played on was called Woody's Gold Star on Concord Records. And we had a chart on In a Mellow Tone, and Woody knew that that was contrafacted from, help me out, Rose Room, right, Rose Room. And so Woody decided he would take that chart and put Rose Room on the front of it, and then we'd go into the chart. And by the way, the chart was written not by our chief arranger, John Fetchok, but by his wife, who was named Maria Schneider. And she's done pretty good for herself since then. But it was a real straight-ahead chart. I think Fetchok probably had his hands full, or maybe even Woody recommended, hey, get Maria to do a chart. I'm not sure how it went down. But Maria did the chart, and it's really swinging. We all had our fingers crossed. I mean, historically, I don't know if you know, but clarinet, Woody was once a really great clarinetist, and by that time, he would tell you he wasn't a very good clarinetist, and he was struggling with it because he had dentures, and he was trying to play high notes like he always did, and it was really kind of rough for him. But I hope the history books will appreciate that Woody Herman kind of invented a style, comes out of New Orleans, really, but kind of invented a style of playing screech over the band, playing like a screech solo on clarinet. And so he had a chorus like that, and the very out half a chorus or so on this chart by Maria Schneider on Mellow Tone had Woody doing that ride over the band kind of thing. And some nights it was wonderful, and some nights it was rough. And so we really had our fingers crossed on that one. And if you listen to the record, Woody came through like a champ. It was really wonderful. We had a great time. But I want you to know the pertinence of this tune in our hearts, because that was the last solo that that Woody ever put on a record. So go and listen to it. It's Woody's Gold Star is the last album. And I told Gerry I was proud and glad that he picked this one. Thank you.
Fantastic. Gerry Pinter. Beautiful. Yeah, Gerry. Nice. And one more time for Katie Thiroux. Gerry Gibbs. Tom Griep. Gerry Pinter again. Ron Stout. Chuck Red. And also, I just want to say, you know, obviously it's been a tough couple of years for all of us, and we're so delighted that you came to this event. And isn't it nice to share music together again with all that's gone on? And so all I have to say is, you know, please tell your friends about these things, and because this is obviously a transition year for everybody. And even though, you know, everybody likes to say, oh, the country's back, you know, together, people don't realize in the arts, it's still not even close. You know, we're still scuffling, and the work's trickling. You know, it's not like a fast-paced re-entry back into things. So we're very grateful you're here. And I want to thank Ken Poston for keeping the momentum going and putting together such beautiful programming. Really. It's worth the trip from New York to come and do these things for you. I love your ideas, and always creative, and so much fun. So we're going to close out this evening with a real staple from the Woody Herman Band. I also wanted to mention, now you played with Woody too, right? Did you not? Oh, that's right. Yeah, 10 days after Ron.
I have to look at the back of my head for 3.5 years.
I only got to play with him. I played with him for a couple weeks. I did. Well, no, we were, Woody, you know, obviously, I think you all know about the, you know, he was struggling, had health problems financially, most of that not his doing, but, did Frank Sinatra not bail him out and help him out financially?
It wasn't Frank, really, it was the jazz fans. Mm. Basically got together and saved his home.
Saved his home,
that's
yeah.
That's all he wanted to keep for his daughter.
Mm. Yeah. But what a tragedy. I got to work with him towards the end of his life because, unfortunately, you know, because of his financial problems, he had to keep disbanding the big band and then do some small group tunes or do some other things, get enough money together, and then, and his health, and then get back on the road again with the band, which he really loved. But he did some stints at the Rainbow Room in New York. And as I recall, because this was a long time ago, the band was... Generally, it was Ruby Brath, George DeVivier, I think. Jake Hanna played drums. I can't remember who played piano. It was Howard Alden on guitar and Scott Hamilton on saxophone. And I was subbing for Scott for a couple of weeks. And Woody, of course. And all we did, it was actually a lot of fun. He was clearly, you know, not in great shape, but having a good time. Because it was like the old days. We were just jamming on songs and having fun. And he was singing and playing and letting guys have feature numbers. And I don't know. You guys knew him much better and played with him a couple of weeks. But I feel it was such an honor just to share the stage with this giant for that amount of time. And you're absolutely right about his clarinet playing. He doesn't get enough credit for that. And it's funny you mentioned this because I've always felt... that of all the great clarinetists, you know, Benny and Artie and Buddy DeFranco, myself, at the top of the list. No, definitely not. No. But that's, oh, he is. Yeah, he's a great clarinetist. But Woody, he did have a real New Orleans influence in his playing. Very funky, you know, bending notes and very bluesy influence. completely different from all those other clarinetists. And I love to listen to him play. And again, you know, that was such a thing to wait for him to start wailing at the end of a chart on top of the band. Very exciting, you know. And this is a tune that I know he'd like to keep increasing the tempo, but we're going to bring it back to more normal, to the ballad it originally was. But we're going to go out with a song that I think this is a true thing, because I got to know Flip Phillips, the great saxophone player, very well. He was like a second father to me. And Flip always claimed that he wrote Apple Honey, not Woody Herman. And I think that's true, because it sounds like a Flip Phillips line. And no offense to Woody, because they all did that back then. All the band leaders, Black and White, you name it. They all put their names on those songs to get part of the publishing money. But this is Apple Honey. And we want to thank you again for attending this. And we hope to see you on lots more of these in the future. And thanks again to Ken Poston. We really appreciate you putting this on. Well, tomorrow afternoon, Terry Gibbs is coming tomorrow. Yeah. You know, he doesn't bother to come when I'm playing, but he's showing up tomorrow. But tell him, oh, we have Gerry, the grandfather, yes. All right, here's Apple Honey. It's better. Ladies and gentlemen, stand up. Take a bow. Thank you, folks. See you tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you so much.